Hello and welcome to Better Geology. I'm Andrew Dunning, and I'm at Craters of the Moon National Monument in Idaho. The Craters of the Moon National Monument in Idaho protects one of the largest volcanic landscapes in North America. This particular lava field encompasses over 1,600 square kilometers of basaltic lava, over 60 different flows, 25 different cinder cones, and a whole plethora of different basaltic and volcanic features. These particular lava flows started erupting about 15,000 years ago, and the most recent one was only 2,000 years ago. As a result, this is considered an active volcanic area, and another volcano will certainly erupt here at some point in the near future. Craters of the Moon is situated in the eastern Snake River Plain, a broad, flat valley that owes its existence to the Yellowstone Hotspot. As this bulge of hot magma rose up into the crust, it pushed up against the landscape and created an area of tension along the top of the hotspot, and this caused faulting to drop down this broad valley. The magma and volcanism associated with the Yellowstone Hotspot also created the Great Idaho Rift, a long series of cracks tens of kilometers long through which this lava rose. In this area, the Snake River Plain is filled with ancient basalts and rhyolite volcanics that date back as far as 16 million years. The Snake River Plain in this area is covered with basalts of different ages going back millions of years, though these ones at Craters of the Moon are some of the youngest in the region. Now, just because the Yellowstone Hotspot is nearby and influences this area greatly does not mean that all of this lava comes directly from the hotspot. Geochemistry of many of the different lava flows in this area reflects a mixture of Yellowstone Hotspot magma and other melting from deeper in the mantle. The upper mantle and the lower crust have zones of melting in them that contribute to the lavas and volcanoes seen in the Snake River Plain. The vast majority of the basalt found at Craters of the Moon is basalt. Now, basalt is a mafic lava. That means it is rich in iron and magnesium primarily, and relatively poor in silica or quartz minerals. A rhyolite lava, on the other hand, is very poor, has very low amounts of iron and magnesium, and is very high in aluminum and silica. Rhyolites will contain as much as 95 to 100% silica, whereas these basalts contain only 45 to 52% by weight of silica and quartz. Basalt erupts along fissures or dikes. The Great Idaho Rift is a series of these fractures, fissures, and dikes along which basaltic volcanoes are able to form. When basaltic magma reaches the surface to erupt as a volcano, it frequently forms cinder cones. When a cinder cone erupts, huge fountains of gas-rich, frothy lava spurt up out of the ground and create these foamy, lightweight cinders of basaltic foam. It's kind of like a sponge of basalt. These are very lightweight and are often carried by the wind. The vent for the cinder cone I'm standing on right now is about 200 meters that way, in the middle of a small horseshoe. Because the prevailing winds that day were very strong, it blew most of these lightweight cinders to the east, where I'm standing now. It appears to be draped over an older cinder cone volcano, but it's very hard to tell without doing a detailed chemical analysis. Many of the largest volcanoes at Craters of the Moon are these cinder cones, and they form the top of the broad shield volcano that these eruptions have produced. Behind me are features called spatter cones, and a spatter cone is what happens when basalt rises along a long fissure, or a dike reaches the surface. These long, linear cracks in the ground along which basaltic magma can erupt form these spatter cones. You get these huge curtains of lava fountaining up out of the ground, and when these blobs of lava reach the ground and start to cool and coalesce and stick together, this is called agglutinate. Cinder cones and spatter cones alike are both formed of agglutinate, or these globs of lava that have stuck together as they cooled. This lava flow I'm standing on now is called the Devil's Orchard Lava Flow. It is undated, but is one of the more recent lava flows here in the park. It is a slightly different composition than many of the other lava flows around here. It is a basaltic andesite, and it contains about 54% silica. This means that the Devil's Orchard lava flow is thicker. It has a much thicker viscosity, is much more resistant to flow, has a blockier surface than many of the other basaltic lava flows here in the park. This thick, blocky, slow-moving mass of lava is able to bulldoze and push around chunks of cinder cones because they are less dense and colder than the lava. These chunks of cinder cones have been moved many miles from their original locations, and they dot the landscape in this part of Craters of the Moon Lava Field and National Monument. Some of these are behind me, and you can see they can become quite large. They range from a few meters in size to as high as 50 meters in size for some of the larger ones. These rafted blocks are unusually common at this part of Craters of the Moon, and they are rarely found in these quantities in other lava fields in the United States and North America. Basaltic lava has two general textures when it forms lava flows. The first is pahoehoe, and is the kind you would probably imagine if you think of a basaltic lava flow. It has this smooth, ropey, or pillowy texture that you can see in these smooth volcanic landscapes. Much of the island of Hawaii is covered in pahoehoe lava flows. The other one is called a'a, which is a very pointy and blocky, rubbly-looking type of lava flow with a very rough surface. The difference in the two textures has to do with their viscosity, temperature, and resistance to flow. Viscosity is a property of any liquid and refers to its resistance to flow, how thick it is. Honey has a very high viscosity, whereas water has a very low viscosity. Basaltic lavas are low in silica, so they tend to be very fluid and move much faster. They have a lower viscosity. A rhyolitic lava is very thick and has a very high viscosity and forms these huge mounds. A pahoehoe lava with a very high temperature is going to have a lower viscosity and is going to flow much more easily than an a'a with a lower temperature. If a very thick lava tries to flow quickly, it reaches a downhill slope where it's very steep, it's going to break apart and form something like a blocky or an a'a texture. A very hot, very thin lava like a pahoehoe flowing slowly across a flat landscape is going to be very smooth, and this is how we get some of these smoother textures. A pahoehoe can become an a'a, but it's very rare for an a'a to become a pahoehoe. To really appreciate the scale and the beauty of this magnificent volcanic landscape, you really will have to come here and see it for yourself. The amount of lava that stretches from any given viewpoint all the way to the horizon is staggering, even when obscured by the historic wildfire smoke from fall of 2020. This has been Better Geology. I'm Andrew Dunning. Thank you for watching.